Mr. Haru has passed out from Christ Law College. Mr. Haru has practiced under several advocates, and he has been an independent counsel for several advocates. Currently, he is now a partner at CRAR Advocates and Solicitors. He is an independent counsel for Sorana and Company. He is an independent counsel for King Stubb and Kasiwa Advocates and Solicitors. He is an independent counsel for Lexport Law Firm. He is an independent counsel for RIMS Legal. He is an independent counsel for Satyagraha Law Group. And also he has been advising HPCL, Vista ITCL, HDFC Bank. And also he has his own practice, and he runs his own law firm also. So today we will be learning from Haru about the Mohammedan personal laws. All second semester students, I think all of you are reading Mohammedan law as of now. And today it's a great opportunity to know the practical side of the practice in Mohammedan field. So this today's video will be one set of video we'll be discussing. We'll be doing a series of video under Haru's guidance. And today we'll be discussing with regard to who is a Muslim as per Mohammedan laws, and Islamic law applicability in India, and marriage and talaq. We'll restrict to these three topics. If these three topics are not coverable, we'll be covering in several other seminars in coming days. So we welcome you, Haru. The stage is all yours. We can start the seminar. And thank you for the opportunity you're providing for all our law students.
Thank you, sir, for providing an opportunity of being a medium of learning. And I hope all my words and the teachings will be useful for your students and make them better lawyers than me.
Absolutely, sir. You are much more in a different level altogether. We have to learn from you to reach to you.
First pounding a stone in any subject of law, I would consider as humility, which every law student should know. That Absolutely. Is the basis of all our knowledge.
Yeah.
So basically, we will start the session with your permission, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Sure, sir. Yeah. So today, what I will be dealing with is the first introduction to Mohammedan law. And when it comes to Mohammedan law, one needs to understand one very important concept, that is, what is Islam and who falls under Mohammedan law. So the commonly term which is used worldwide for Islamic law is called the Sharia or Shariat. Basically, it's been derived from an Arabic word wherein it lays down the laws made by the holy books, that is the Holy Quran. And in all Muslim countries, they follow the Sharia law very strictly, because this law is assumed to be got from the holy books through the word of God. So that is where the start of this particular law happens. Now, when it comes to law itself, we need to also see that one lawyer should have a definition of his own about what is law. There are various definitions in jurisprudence, which is done by various justices, other philosophers, and also judges in some cases as to what is law. And to my personal belief and the experience, I have seen people relating law to logic. Sometimes that's the most simplest definition people come out with. You know, the law should be logical. So therefore, here when we see what is law, we will come down to a pedestrian level of showcasing what else will be considered as law. So first of all, I believe law is a set of rules and regulations created by the society for its own benefit and its own regulation. Why the law? Why the law? Because without regulating oneself, there is a chance of anarchy and there is complete you know, there is nothing in order and nothing goes according to the, you know, whatever regulation you want to bring in. So the reason we need to question oneself as to why we need to have law in our, you know, entire, life. So the need for law comes for most of many reasons, which you will never find in the textbooks. This is my personal experience and my personal research, which I have gone through, and the cases which I have gone through, wherein I can cite out the reasons as to why there should be a law. I hope I am audible. Abhilash sir, can you confirm whether my voice is
clear? Fine and clear.
Great, sir. Great, sir.
Yep.
So, why the law? Point number one, we humans have been, you know, having a psychological, you know, effect, wherein if certain things go in certain way regularly, we accept those things. And when that things are accepted, it becomes a norm. So therefore, one needs to understand very clearly as to why we need the law. Then we will get into the different types of law, in which Islamic law will come into picture, and then we will jump into the existence of Islamic law and so forth and so forth. So, in my personal opinion, one, it sets your entire, you know, procedure or a protocol through which you know this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in an order. So therefore, it is very important for things to be in order. There should be a law governing such particular action or inaction of a person or a group of persons or an organization. So that is the reason we have laws. Now, when we have laws, we need to understand where these laws are originated. How does this law come into picture? What is the real genesis of where the law has been born? So when we see into the history and the books, one important aspect of the source of law is through religious text, word of God, the law made through the Shastras, and so on and so forth. And today, while dealing with Mohammedan law or the Islamic Shariat law, we are clinging from that very branch from where the law is coming. So first of all, we understood what is law, why do we need law, and now from where this branch of Islamic law is originating, that is one of the sources of law which is prehistorical and which is mostly accepted by the word of God or any religious scripts which has been, you know, been sent from generations to generations in order to follow, in which the life is more convenient. See, all the laws are made for convenience. The origin was for the reason for convenience. But later on, what happens is, one very bad, you know, impact human society has on the individual. So now there are two things. One is society, another is individual. We need to always understand that both of them have separate rights. You are an individual. Your rights are of a paramount nature. But at the same time, there is another pedestal known as the other than you people, which is a society, who is going to accept you or who are going to not accept you or whatever reason. So therefore, it is very important that we see that this law is actually applicable, acceptable, and followable. Something made which we cannot follow, cannot consider as law. So therefore, this origin of Muslim law comes from the niche or the branch or the roots of one of the sources of law, that is religious laws, from the holy books or from the Shastras or from whatever holy things or the holy saints have set those norms. Those customs from time to time till this day have taken a form or a face of law. Hence, from there is the birth of the Sharia law. When the Islam religion was founded by Prophet Muhammad, so peace be upon him, when he founded the religion, and when he was blessed and bestowed with the holy book of Quran, in which the God Allah have spoken to the, you know, the rest of the world, which is the word of the God, which is known as the Quran. Through that, there are certain aspects of life. Now, these aspects of life include the very basics. First is, what is your right? Like, what you should do, what you should not do, and what others can do to you and what others cannot do to you. So from this started the discussion of rights from the holy book of Quran. So they started with the rights of individual, stating that he should be given an audience of hearing, which is very, very important. So the law of hearing the other side, or audi alteram partem, as it is in Latin, that is the law of fair hearing from the principles of natural justice, was also taken up in this particular religious law as well. No doubt about it that other religious laws also have these principles been adopted and taken from the very niche, but this gives us an understanding that the importance of such a principle in particularly Mohammedan or Islamic or Sharia law. So this is the most basic individual right which an individual gets at the very inception, very birth, right? He gets the right of, first, right to live. Second is right to speak. Third is right to fair hearing, which is included in both of those rights. So that is how we need to understand the Sharia law. So this is one of the principle of individual rights. Now, mostly when it comes to the Sharia practice or the Sharia law, the very important aspect is, we should see, we are in a country that is India, and we follow a constitution, that is the Constitution of India, correct? 1950. So we are the followers of Constitution. Sir, we will follow the Constitution. What about the application of Sharia law upon us? Because we are a secular country. When we are a secular country, why should we follow the Sharia law? So therefore, in respect to answering that question, I would like to highlight one particular article in the Constitution of India, which shows how the, you know, Constituent Assembly and the fathers of Constitution have adopted Sharia law, and for what purpose they have adopted Sharia law. So as I told you, and also let me just inform everybody that anybody has a doubt and anybody has a question, they are free to interrupt me at any point of time, so that, you know, you don't pile up your doubts, or else you can also take down the notes of your doubts, and in the last 10-15 minute session we can conclude with the doubts as well. I'm open for both, but the object is the importance of your time and my time. So I need you to understand, because I am putting lot of efforts so that you people understand as to real aspects of the particular law, because I want to make this a very fruitful session. So you are free to interrupt me at any given time of point also, whenever you're not understanding. So going back to my Article 13 in the Constitution of India. So Article 13 of the Constitution of India, I would request all of you, if you are in your mobiles or even on your laptops, to just Google or even take up Article 13 of the Indian Constitution 1950, because I believe in learning together, which is the best way of, you know, interpreting and helping you people learn. So here, Article 13 of the Indian Constitution states that laws inconsistent with or in derogation of the fundamental rights. This is a particular article. If you have paid attention in your constitutional classes, I'm sorry, because I am a constitutional student, I always bring in constitution in every of my class. So as a constitutional student, this is a very basic article one should read, because this is the definition of law in the Constitution of India. So Article 13 gives us the definition of law or the scope of law, or the laws which India has taken and adopted and considered to be laws. Now, as you know very well, that our country was under the colonial rule of the British. We had all the ills, no doubt about it, but also we did inherit a lot of goods, which we cannot ignore and which we should acknowledge. So one of the good aspects of colonization was that they had several laws being passed pre-independence. So those laws were already there. Those laws were already being made and it was in force. We just adopted those laws. And even after the independence, we followed those laws. And how did we do it? Through this particular article, that is Article 13 of the Indian Constitution. And Article 13.1, may please read the article so that you understand, all laws in force in the territory of India immediately before the commencement of this constitution, insofar as they are inconsistent with the provisions of this part, shall to the extent of such inconsistency be void. Now, this is a form of drafting. Now, I'm going to teach you drafting as well, drafting of the laws. So you will have a multiple facet into our particular lecture. See the words, how they are drafted in this particular article, how they are mentioned and told that all that is being accepted except for those which are not inconsistent or which are not proper as per this part, that is the fundamental rights. Anything clashing with the fundamental rights would be free to struck down. Otherwise, if it does have fair hearing, if it does follow all the principles of natural justice, if it does follow all the tests of human rights and other things, the law will be considered as applicable. Now, let me give you one very, very commonly used Muslim law, not only Muslim law, in the issues of religious laws. So the very aspect of learning Mohammedan law should be considered because we will be dealing into personal situations. Now the personal situations meaning marriage, succession, inheritance, and the other aspects of marriage. And some of the parts as wills, gifts. So that comes under your personal, capacity. So that is how we need to understand why these religious laws are being accepted by the framers of our constitution in order to give them validity so that we still have secularism maintained. Secularism does not mean intolerance. It means a lot of tolerance, but not beyond the reasonability of good conscience. That was in a very famous international case, I am forgetting. But subsequently, I will tell you the name of the case or where I happen to read that particular ratio. So what we need to see is that anything which is inconsistent with part 3 of the constitution, that will be void. Apart from that, everything will be considered as law. And the law which I was talking to you about, which is commonly used in Mohammedan law. Nowadays, lot of cases. Now this I am telling you on practical basis. What is the real use in practice? Most of the cases are this 498A cases or dowry cases or domestic violence cases or, taking the custody of a child, whether a child can be adopted, and what is the validity of a will, what is the validity of the gift, which is called hiba in Muslim law, all those aspects. Now, the law which I was talking to you about was section 498A of Indian Penal Code. Now, if you notice, this Indian Penal Code, I don't know whether it's going to come as a reflection, it is of 1860. The Indian Penal Code itself is of a pre, independence era law, which is still a very good law. So that is where, through this example, I want to show you, reading with the Article 13 of the Indian Constitution, how the Sharia law was accepted as a law in India. And the reasons of, you know, taking the Sharia law is also being told to you now, that, you know, you needed tolerance, you needed harmony, because which is also there in the preamble of our constitution, if you see. That is the basis of our very constitution. One may also shoot this preamble of constitution in Google or in your particular web, this thing, browsers. And while reading the preamble, you see how the important aspects, sovereignty, social, is being socialist, secular, democratic, republic. Together, these things are very dangerous because they have heavy meanings. And then they say justice, and then they say equality, and then they say fraternity. So all these things together needed for the framers of the constitution to have section Article 13 in place, whereby they could give validity to pre-independence law. And therefore now I come to you with the Shariat Act of 1937. So now you will tell me, sir, you could have just told about the Shariat Act 1937 before, why you had to give us the entire history. But I promise you that you will never forget why the applicability of the Shariat Act of 1937 happens in India. Now that you are very sure as to why this is applicable, now we will get into the act as to why it is applicable. So the Shariat Act of 1937 is a pre-independence law, comes under Article 13 and becomes a valid law. And now this act is just few pages. It just says that all the customs norms followed by the, you know, Muslims in through the Holy Quran and the main Sharia law will be considered as law. The personal rights, the rights relating to inheritance, the rights relating to marriage, the rights relating to adoption, the rights relating to, you know, gift, will. There are a lot of aspects. Now, when there is a religious law existing, in that scenario, whether you will go for the applicability of religious law, or will you touch upon the Transfer of Property Act for the distribution of assets, is a very important and a crucial question, which will take away and consume entire of one of my session. In future, we shall discuss that as well. But in this scenario, I again would want to quote the article in the Constitution itself, wherein there is an effect given to personal laws. When there is an effect given to personal laws, sometimes you would have also come across in jurisprudence about this lex specialis, lex generalis rule. In Latin, it means special law prevails over general law. So therefore, when there is an existence of special law, that will prevail upon the operations of general law. And also, the very hot topic which is currently running inside the parliament as a debate, and there are few cases in the Honorable Supreme Court of India, is about you know, having uniform civil code. So in this aspect also, we need to also follow the daily news and also our, you know, the opinions of the judges in the Honorable Supreme Court of India, if they pass any, like they passed for the triple talaq and on and so forth. We have to keep in touch of those things to understand how and to what extent these laws will be applicable. So the Uniform Civil Code is highlighted in Article 44 of the Indian Constitution, wherein the state shall make endeavors to secure the citizens of Uniform Civil Code throughout the country of India. So here, there are many cases as to explaining how important personal laws are for the people, and what all difficulties we will face if we will disturb the personal laws. So in that scenario, now we understand as to what is the sensitivity of personal laws over general laws. So therefore, it is very important that we have to learn the personal laws. So even if the UCSC is brought about, you cannot escape the subject of Muslim law or Hindu law or any other laws, because they were already in place, and no law will be retrospective when they pass to the parliament, because it will fail. So in this scenario, keeping in mind that, you know, we will have to deal with the Muslim law in our litigation and practice for the coming 50 years or so minimum, we will learn the concept of Muslim law. So the law takes its origin in Saudi Arabia, because the religion of Islam was born in Mecca, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had put all his efforts, and then slowly the religion kept, you know, spreading, and it reached to various parts of the world, and there were many settlements wherein the Muslims took their place, and through which we see that those norms or customs which were followed and which are present in the holy books were accepted widely by all the Muslims, and those were the, you know, those conditions were taken a face of law, and presently till date they are, you know, enforceable, and they are being accepted and followed even in India through the Shariat Act of 1937, and later few other laws came about, which I will deal with later when I deal only with Muslim law and women, so that I have a very special session to that, and I would like to only have only about the Muslim personal law with regards to women, and how, what are the rights there. In this, I will be dealing with the first of my particular, as shared in the subject, that who is a Muslim. So in order to understand Sharia law, we need to understand upon whom the law will be applicable. So like I have already highlighted to Abhilash sir, four main important criteria where I had to explain was who is a Muslim, Islamic law applicability in India in the light of constitution, which we have already dealt, and now I'll come to who is a Muslim, and then issues of marriage and talaq and inheritance and so on and so forth. So when it comes to who is a Muslim, in Hindu law there is a definition which is already been in place under the Hindu Marriage Act, which defines the term Hindu. Whereas Sharia law, you see, it is not very, you know, definitively mentioned as to who is a Muslim. But it indicates as to all the things what a Muslim should do. So therefore, in that light, there was a time when a need arose for the Honorable Supreme Court of India to explain and interpret who is a Muslim. Because the Supreme Court came across this in Lily Thomas and others versus Union of India and others in the year 2000. So here, the Supreme Court goes on to explain by stating the word Muslim, that in Arabic is an active principle of Islamia, which means acceptance of faith. Now, whoever accepts his faith as into Islam, he becomes a Muslim. Now, Muslim law is admittedly based on recognized system of jurisprudence, providing many rational and revolutionary concepts. So, in a book on Mohammedan law by Sir Amir Ali, Tagore Law Lectures, 4th edition, volume 1, has observed that the Islamic system from a historical point of view, was the most interesting phenomenon of growth, and in which they brought out the concept of Muslim as the person who has his faith in Islam. The first and most important pillar or the test every lawyer should understand when he is litigating or arguing before a judge or wherever possible, that we need to bring out what is the test to show, you know, whether that person is a Muslim. Similarly, any concept when it comes before any judge, we bring out a lot of tests and principles already laid down to explain the situation. In the present instance, the first and foremost test is whether he has given Shahada. And now you will ask me, sir, what is Shahada? What is this Arabic terms? It is nothing but, it is a simple declaration. Many people have many complicated definitions of it, which explained in a lot of other cases as well. But I would like you to understand in the most simple fashion that it is a declaration. It is a declaration by an individual saying that there is no God except Allah and Prophet Muhammad is his prophet. That translates into, in Arabic, who reads the Shahada, that is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Basically, meaning what I just narrated. They have to declare and they have to give an oath towards the Creator that we believe from today, my faith is upon a religion in which we believe in Allah as a supreme being. As you know that Islamic law is one of the monotheistic religion. And it is also known as an Abrahamic religion because the Jews, the Christians, they also have holy books, and then they also follow one God and they had their own prophets. So likewise, Islam also falls into a religious belief of having one God. So basically, the first test one should apply is whether that person's faith is that he believes that Allah is the only one God and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his prophet. This is the first test. Second test, when it comes, it shows that that person is born, how the person is born to. Like in the Hindu laws, you see, there are a lot of instances wherein even if one of the parent is a, you know, Hindu, then Hindu law may be applicable to the child as well. And the child has a right to choose. But whereas in Muslim law, what happens is, very interestingly, it differs. Now, we have to understand one aspect when it comes to learning the personal laws. Our first mantra or, you know, our first rule should be that we should not have any prejudices. Because if you have prejudices, you will block your mind and you will not allow yourself to learn what exists. And without learning what exists, you cannot counter or you cannot place your views. So in order to place your views, you need to first respect what the view is of the other person. In this case, a Muslim. So the first step is to keep yourself away from all sorts of prejudices and think what this particular religion is. It has certain foundations, stones. Now from the foundation stones, what is highlighted is there are five pillars of Islam. That is the five things which a Muslim should do during his lifetime and which is mandatory, it's obligatory, it's not, optional. So those five things are that he should first read the Shahada, then he should offer the namaz five times a day, pray five times, then he should offer, he should observe fast in Ramzan, and then he should make all his efforts to visit the Mecca and do his pilgrimage of Hajj. And, you know, lastly, that he should follow all the norms of the community. Now, when this particular thing is there, there are certain norms which have taken the face of law, wherein certain times, certain things are not accepted on individual basis and in society level basis. Now, the first problem arises is during marriages. In marriages, what happens in Islam is their religion, in the Sharia law, they accept marriage to monotheistic religions such as Christianity or Jews, because they also have the same holy books concept, one God concept, and it's believed that all those were transformations happening, and those beings or religions just stood at that level and they did not choose to progress. So whereas more or less the principles coincide, and you know, that is why these people accept that they can marry one of those. In fact, in Parsis, the law is more strict. So that's why they have this, you know, marriage among only their own people. But right now, what we see in a lot of situations and scenarios and cases, we see, you know, people having of a broad understanding, a liberal view of family, a liberal view of marriage, and running, you know, institutions such as family. So therefore, we will have to see as to whether the Sharia law will apply onto that person or not. So basically, when the person reads the Shahada and his name is a Muslim and his parents are Muslim, and you know, he's following the path, the faith of Islam, the Sharia law is applicable to him. So first and foremost, special law should be looked into in dealing with all the personal affairs of inheritance, succession, marriage, gift, will, and so on and so forth. And they should be made to sit in a higher pedestal, and then the other, you know, common laws will come into picture. So in Lily Thomas was a landmark case wherein the Supreme Court actually had a chance to discuss who could be a Muslim or who cannot be a Muslim. And sadly, after going through the entire judgment as well, I have my own reservations, and every lawyer should have his own reservations. Please remember, any judgments you read, it is not that, you know, it's like a patarka laki that you cannot cross and stuff like that, because there's always a scope for the law to change, evolve, take his own shape. So as a lawyer, you should have a mind very open towards things. So I feel many other aspects could have been included, but because there are other limitations, the honorable judges did not want to venture into, you know, picking and choosing and making it, you know, more complicated, because courts are, to their point, they will not involve into questions which are not related to the case. Only when it is dire need of the case and something is not available is only when the honorable courts will interfere and try to interpret the particular provision. So now we will discuss upon what are the sources of Muslim law. Before, when I told you that religious law is a branch and a niche, that was from one of the sources of law through which Islamic law came into force. Now we will understand in depth as to what are the sources of Islamic law. Because being a religious law, it is not sufficient to, you know, recognize only Quran as a source. There is a vast jurisprudence behind the entire Muslim law or the Sharia law or the Islamic law. So we need to understand very importantly the sources of Muslim law. When it comes to the sources of Muslim law, again, the sources will be divided into primary sources and secondary sources. Primary sources are the ones which will be taken into consideration at a higher pedestal, you know, premier ones. And then the secondary sources will be looked into if the answer is not found in the primary source, or interpret the primary source in a manner so as to apply to the situation, we will look into the secondary sources. So the primary sources, my friends, anybody can open the Google, or you know, they can just note down, is the Quran. The Holy Quran is the first and foremost primary source of all the Muslim jurisprudence. Anything, like I told you in Article 13, this is Indian Constitution. This was done by the framers of the Constitution. They had a thought about it, and they had mentioned Article 13's wording very carefully, that anything inconsistent with the Part 3 will be not considered as law and it will be void. Likewise, in Muslim jurisprudence, one needs to understand that anything, any secondary source which is inconsistent with the holy book, Holy Quran, that source will not be accepted. So anything which is accepted in by the Holy Quran, by the norms of the Holy Quran, may be the extension, more bigger interpretation, or you know, explanation towards the primary source, will be accepted. But whereas when it comes to anything from the secondary source which is against the primary source, that is Quran, that is the test applied to check the validity of Islamic law. Now, I had the very opportunity of being in the meeting of the All India Muslim Law Personal Law Board during the times of the triple talaq issues, which was discussed in the Honorable Supreme Court of India, and representations were being made, and many of the aspects were discussed. And at length, that triple talaq judgment also, if anybody goes through, they'll get a lot of jurisprudence, in which the Honorable Supreme Court also has taken the very stand which is consistent with the Holy Quran. That is, not anything which is inconsistent with the Holy Quran. So it was already there. In fact, we had made suggestions to the respected honorable, the higher authorities, so-called, in all the Islamic, the All India Personal Law Board. And we did made a suggestion stating that when we can issue a statement itself that, through the Quran, that anything inconsistent with the Quran is invalid for us, and therefore those WhatsApp talaqs and other talaqs will be invalid. It would have been much easier for the Honorable Supreme Court to conclude the case and concentrate into other cases as well. But unfortunately, you see, that is the problem when you have to say that, it's a free country with free speech and, free expressions. It will take its own time. You cannot impose all your views. But it was a very fine judgment wherein it did come to the same conclusion that it was not in the main source. Therefore, the Honorable Supreme Court of India also rightly decided the aspects of talaq, and they also highlighted, anybody could go through those judgments, they will find the verses of the Quran and the test applied by the Honorable Supreme Court of India, the judges, the Honorable bench, very knowledgeable, especially, there was also a dissent opinion as well, but I don't want to get into the in detail depth of triple talaq judgment, because that itself will consume a lot of time. So here now, the sources of Muslim law will be, first and foremost, it will be Quran. Now, second source of Muslim law would be Hadith. Now, what is Hadith? Hadith are the various narrations by the people who lived during the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the time of Arabia. So his practices, those cases which came about during his lifetime, and how they were decided, and how the Quran was interpreted or put into situations in cases of divorce, in cases of adoption, in cases of other things, all those things, those were recorded by the Sahabas. Now the Sahabas are the followers, very close followers, or the persons who record all information who were with the Prophet. There'll be a member, like a king has his own courtyard with those important Navratnas, like that. So these people are one of the very close companions of the Prophet, who have carefully recorded the instances through which now we see how that practice became law later on in the form of hadith. And later we have the secondary sources, that is the ijma or consensus of opinions. Ijma is something which is they come to a point wherein they discuss as to whether that law will fit into the particular situation. If the particular law fits into that particular situation, why and how and what is the impact? Now, this is again given by scholars. These are not hadith, because the difference is this is not recorded by the persons who were living at the time. This may be, like if you apply the logic, the ijmas, some of the ijmas may be hadith, but all hadith cannot be ijma. All hadith can be ijma because it is of the elders as well, elders' opinion, but all ijma is not hadith. Later on, who all took up the position of the qazi? Qazi is a person who is judge in an Islamic court. They come up with all these opinions and consensus. So there, they carefully store, because they know these situations will repeat. So that is why that became a form of law, that it was accepted back then, and it is a good law. We shall follow the same. So this came under the good practices. So therefore, the ijma comes after hadith. And later, we have the customs and usages. Very importantly, that what were the customs being followed by the time of the people then, and what were the, the usages of that custom. Like, for example, there were a lot of agreements, bilateral agreements, multilateral agreements between the people during the time of wars, during the time of conquest, during the times of spreading the, word, or, having a collaboration. So there are a lot of contractual obligations. So therefore, that is where we come across this customs and usages, and we store those particular things also as laws. So then we have, in lastly, juristic deductions. Now, juristic deductions are very important because these are the case laws which have been preserved. Basically, these are the case laws. What all disputes were referred and the disputes got resolved, and how those disputes were resolved, those recordings were kept so that in future any dispute arises, a person can fall back to the same case and then decide the present case, which will save the time. So all the objects of preserving judgments or preserving laws is to save time. But now we do come across situations where there are two conflicting opinions, but then you have to understand that there are opinions. What if we did not have them? What if we did not have any opinions? In that case, what would be the guiding unit for us to take any decision? So all these are the guiding, units as to taking our own decision. It is the let me put it this way, that judges cannot be compelled. You see, even the lower court judge also cannot be compelled beyond certain limits, saying that citing Article 145 or 141, or saying that the laws are from the Honorable High Supreme Court of India, it should be followed. There will be certain things based on the facts and circumstances which may not apply to that particular case. He is not obliged at that time. So therefore, there is always a scope that the laws will evolve, will take its different shape. So we should study law without prejudice. It's very important. We should not have a stand. If you have a stand while studying law, you will not become a good lawyer. I mean, that's my statement. I don't know. We have people who are great lawyers, but if you need to, at least you will be a very great judge if you do not have any stand and you study law, you understand law, and you know how to use the law. Because law is like a sword. It is a double-edged sword. You can swing it the way you want to. You can either be a person who is going to judge a situation and provide justice, or you can also be that judge who has given a wrong judgment and committed murder by, you know, convicting some innocent person. So you have to be very careful when it comes to law. People have forgotten the very importance of law. They consider only medical field or certain fields are which are very important, and they give least importance to law. But whereas the law is the very most important and the most sensitive, the most crucial field, which has to be studied very carefully, very carefully. So therefore, today we have completed the sources of Muslim law, wherein we saw primary source as the Holy Quran, the secondary source as the Hadith, the Ijma, that is the consensus of the opinions, customs and usages, and juristic deductions. So these are the very sources of the Islamic law, in which we will have to, you know, consider while drafting any petition or rendering any legal opinion to anybody. And we will have to look into these aspects carefully before advising them, because we are, you know, obligated by the Advocates Act very strictly to render very, you know, careful opinions. So therefore, we cannot just cite on the basis of reason, but we will have to also give them the very genesis as to what is the actual law and how it should be followed, and how one can, you know, involve himself in getting justice from the courts using these particular laws. So due to the paucity of time, I have just covered the two particular aspects, that is, who is a Muslim, Islamic law applicability in India in the light of constitution. We will be soon getting into the aspects of marriage and talaq and the inheritance and succession and so forth in our next session. And moreover, lastly, on a light note, I would like to discuss with you a few cases which I had dealt, and in which, you know, how people come to you and you should be ready to understand the situations. So when a Muslim person comes to you for an advice, so first and foremost thing we should know as to which school of thought that person belongs to. So we are going to deal with the school of thought in the next lecture, when we are doing that inheritance part and also the, you know, marriage wala part. So we will have to understand as to which particular school of jurisprudence is that person following. And then there are four types of schools of jurisprudence in Muslim law: the Hanfi, the Hanbali, the Shafi, and the Maliki. So basically, these are the four imams. They are called the imams, the teachers who have set their own jurisprudence or the line of law. So we should understand as to which particular school of thought the person belongs to. And then we should also keep in mind that, you know, principles of personal tolerance when it comes to understanding things, because certain things will be really complicated. They will be referring to always, you know, Maulanas, or it was done this way or that way. We need to kind of give it some patience, hearing, and then listen to their entire situation, and then firstly deduce as to what exactly they require from us. Because in Muslim law, it is very complicated. You cannot render advices just based on understanding one situation. You will have to record all the events and then analyze as to on which particular aspect the person is looking for the advice. And we should know from where we need to dig and pull out the information we need to understand that particular law and its applicability. And then only we should render our legal opinion to that particular person. And in issues of marriage and talaq, I'll be discussing with you other few cases. In this particular session, I could only complete the part of who is a Muslim and the basis foundations of Muslim law. And I really hope that soon Abhilash sir will be giving an opportunity to touch the main issues of marriage, talaq, and other particular topics. I am grateful to Abhilash sir, his team, and the Teachers Law College, and I wish them very best of luck. And I really appreciate that, you know, even in these tough times, the school is taking, the law school is taking efforts in bringing in practical, you know, experience from advocates, which is, I tell you, priceless. It is priceless, simply priceless, because it is not easy. Every advocate, no, they are not free to come to the colleges. We have a lot of zeal to come to colleges and take lectures for the people. But the problem is we are so much entangled with our profession, because once you jump into the profession, it's a vast field. It's an ocean. So I am thankful for the opportunity that I could meet so many people, and I could be a medium of understanding some aspects of the Muslim law to start with. And also, I am told that I'll be dealing with few other subjects as well. So subsequently, I shall see you all in the coming lecture series. And I also wish every one of you all the very best. And I would want 5 minutes of the time from Abhilash sir in questioning as to any person having any doubts, any concerns, or any misunderstandings over the topic, so that I can clarify.
Yes, yes, thank you.
I think Ms. Navya is having some doubts.
Just a Max. Navya, yes, you can ask your question.
Hello, sir.
Hello, ma'am.
Sir, my question does not relate to the topic which you have explained. Can I go ahead and ask?
No problem. Sir, you can shoot.
I find Muslim law very interesting. And I want to know why Muslim law does not have an option of adoption, only acknowledgement of paternity. What is the reason behind it? I want to know.
Actually, Navya, to be very honest with you, that will consume 1 hour lecture.
To just shorten
the entire gist is that, you know, that law is a thought process, correct? Which is acceptable by majority. This is also a definition of law. So at that point of time, when the religion was at its peak to being expanded, so at that time, the thought process was such that it was a very dangerous time, Navya. There were a lot of issues regarding the paternity or the of deciding who is the father of the child, and it was a very cruel world that time. So issues of adoption are related to somewhere down the line. There are also related to the paternity of the child or who is the father of the child and stuff. So in Muslim law, what happens is they have a kind of a natural law approach. Now, when I mean natural law, I do not mean the natural law in the stricto sensu of the jurisprudence theory. I am meaning for the natural law as in, if you see, even in, let me take just one small example, please don't misunderstand me. The concept of where Aristotle says that man is a social animal, but he's an animal. So let me just bring you to the jungle and then understand the jungle laws. There are instances where there are certain, you know, for instance, the animals who give birth in various other animals' nests and so forth. And there happens to have a lot of atrocities by that person. By that animal upon that the baby or infant, whoever has been brought in. So considering that, what the Islamic law is very fearful of is that the notion what it has is there are boundaries wherein the person may not accept. That is a hard truth. It all depends on the psychology, but also when you read the psychology of many human behaviors, and few psychological studies as well, ultimately you will come to know that there are a lot of ill effects wherein if adoption is allowed, as adoption giving the same name as the father, it raises a lot of questions. To this, I will just conclude by mentioning one case which I personally dealt in my experience, and I cannot disclose the names of the parties, but I will tell you the facts and circumstances of the case. The facts and circumstances of the case were that the person was picked up by one of the relative. That relative had 3 children. This person had no children. So he picked up the newborn baby, made to show that this baby is that person's. And in future, when it came to, say, when he was in the about to get adult, there arose a lot of issues. And the child was a female. So I cannot, in detail tell you everything. But as an indication, let me tell you, the Muslim law is strict because it believes in that philosophy wherein, you know, even if a string is placed in a place where there is dim light, no, it looks like a snake. So we don't want that doubt. As per their thought, it's not about our this thing. It's their perception. It's their perception. And moreover, they have this thing that saying that you will never be able to give that, that particular love or that particular place. To be very specific, that particular space. I mean, that place will come into any time in the future, it will come as a conflict. So whereas when it is not given and you are treating him it like from the childhood, you are treating him with his own individual rights. See, as soon as you become the parent, upon this age of 1 to 18 years, you have rights over your child. And you can abuse your rights as well, according to the scholars of those people who advocate that particular stand. So to remove that abuse, so that he has individuality, he has been said that he is a child of God. He will be given to madrasas, or he will be, looked into as an individual capacity, and no one can interfere. They have more very strict rights compared to other children or even your own children. They have the separate set of rights. They have to be taken care of very specially. So that is their thinking. But this is the main aspect why they don't want or they don't encourage that particular adoption. What they say is there is no need to have this sham or create a shadow and show that you are giving the father's name to that person, making him emotionally involved, and something goes wrong with his life again in future. What is the thing? Why not keep the truth? And I forgot to mention, I'm really sorry, that one of the most important pillar of Islam is truth. Without truth, they will not accept it. So that is why they think that, what if future, what psychological effect that person might have, or during that 1 to 18 year span of time, given the adoption deed or made him adopted father or mother, how they can abuse to prevent that abuse. That is the stand they have. That is one thinking what they have. Not necessary that every person will do or will not do, but they want to take a precautionary measure. That is why they say that it can be taken that way, that you are an adopted father that acknowledged this thing, and you can still love the child, you can still take care of the child, you can do whatever you want to, but you cannot enforce your rights, because adoption will get rights to the parents. Now the parents should not abuse those rights, because he is not he's not of his own clan, no? Even if that in den of lions, you see, there is always a thing, when there's a cub from another thing, they kill it. So that is the reason they cite, which is, they also would have thought, Navya, of course, there's a lot of jurisprudence behind this. It's just that people don't know. Now, if they ask some answers, or a person who doesn't know the law will just say that, no, it's written in Quran, it is done this, it is done that, all that. But a true lawyer will always get into the cause and see as to why exactly that law was like that. So I have ventured into that aspect as well while teaching in Ramaya to my students. This came up. And in fact, I did bring up and I did explain to them, this is the psychology and mentality that this group of people had. That is why the law was like that. So that is their own personal reservations. They don't want, anything to go wrong with the child, and they surrender the child to the God, the Almighty Allah, and they take care of it in a very special manner. They don't deprive of any rights. They are very strict laws. They cut off their heads if anything goes wrong with the child, you know, even if the mutawalis, that is in madrasas and all, even if the teachers or something, they abuse some child, it is taken as a very serious offense. So they have their own set of norms at that time. There's nothing emotionally, there's nothing attached to this. So apart from thinking emotionally, if a person is taking a stand as to understanding what is the real reason to see that they don't accept adoption, that is the very reason that they don't want this complications, and they want their religion people to not get into, they call it as fitna. Fitna means confusion. So that is why they have this particular law. As per my research till date, if anything new comes up, definitely I will alert you of that particular circumstance. I hope this answers your query, Navya.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. And I feel after your explanation, it is totally justified also.
Maybe. Just, perception, you know. Just
perception.
Yes, sir. You don't really know as to... Anything can be abused and anything can be used for the betterment of human life, ma. I really have open opinions. So I really... the question was very... You know, it was very apt for this situation because you gave an introduction to my next classes. So now you know how will we deal with the learning of the law in the future classes.
Actually, I'm a fourth sem student, sir. I had second semester we had Muslim law. Great. So now I'm in fourth sem. That is why, I wanted to know this answer.
Anytime, Navya. We are. I am very thankful to Abhilash sir and his father. And we've seen a lot of good work that been done by them in spreading the awareness of law, which is our core duty, Navya. As lawyers, our first core duty is to spread the awareness. It's just that it's a very tough profession, Navya. It's a very tough profession. People don't tell you that. With the little experience I've seen, it looks all fancy and, you know, it looks very charming and all. But the hurdles the person goes through in this profession is not simple. There are a lot of ethical decisions, moral decisions, practical decisions, legal decisions. It involves everything, Navya. So anytime you have any queries whatsoever, I am definitely sure Abhilash sir is there. And if he allows me, even I am here to clarify anybody of yours, the queries or doubts or whatever things, to the best of our abilities and, you know, to the best of research we can do and provide you and making you the very best of lawyers in the upcoming time.
Thank you, Harun.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, Amrita, you had a question?
So actually, I just, in continuation to Navya only, I was just asking, Juvenile Justice Act 2015, It is applicable to all the religion for adopter or adoptee. Is it applicable to Muslims also?
See, that is what I said, when there is lex. Now, there are two lex specialis according to you. Now, the Juvenile Justice Act also is a lex specialis. It's not a lex generalis altogether. There are a lot of views of the Honorable Supreme Court of India wherein it has considered juvenile justice as a special law for the child. So, to the extent of the betterment of the child, provisions will not change. Even if the Sharia law comes into picture, provisions will not change. But at the very same time, when it comes that when a Muslim family approaches the particular authority in the Juvenile Justice Board and the other authority which has been made, wherein you can take for adoption, the documentation will differ. So the documentation is very important. There it will differ. And applicability will depend on the facts and circumstances of that particular case at that instance. So whether it should be applicable or not, it will entirely depend on the present situation or facts of that particular case, the age of the minor, the reason for adoption or acknowledgement of this thing. All that thing has to be taken into consideration. So the question is marvelous, but the problem is it is very subjective. So in general, applicability will depend on that particular facts and circumstances. So given circumstance, we can decide how it is applicable, how it is not applicable. But stricto sensu, most of it is not applicable. Only to the extent of the welfare and well-being of the juvenile, the ward is applicable.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. We come to the end of the session, and we will be seeing Harun sir very soon. Whenever he is busy, whenever he is free from his busy schedule, I'll just try to get back in touch with him for his next appointment with all of us. So we thank all students, and we thank Haru sir for giving a wonderful informative seminar on Mohammedan law. So we'll be, I'll try to create a separate YouTube playlist on Mohammedan law, which will be conducted by Haru sir. So we will try to see at least more than 5 or 7 lectures from Haru sir in coming days.
Yeah,
Asif.
Mr. Asif, have a question?
Hi, yes, sir.
Yes, Mr. Asif.
Sir, I have a little doubt.
Yes, Mr. Asif, please tell me.
Yes, sir. Muslim may be categorized under two heads, sir. Muslim by origin and Muslim by conversion.
Right.
Yes, sir. I have a question. Whether a minor Muslim, minor any profess this one, any child can get convert by taking profession, sir?
Excellent question, Asif. So, while explaining to you, when there is two forms of conversion, as Asif puts it, that on the birth, upon the birth, and upon reversion, it's not actually convert. We state that all are Muslims, we just revert back to the Muslim, Islam. So we need to understand that Islamic law is a very, very particular law. It sees marriage also as a contract, and it gives importance to various principles of law. The most important principle of law is the principle of when a person attains majority, when a person can take its own decisions, like I told you, personal aspects of the Muslim law. So here, there are a lot of things which are not applicable in stricto senso when the person is a Muslim by origin. Up to the majority age, many things are forgiven or not, you know, even imposed often, like fast, the namaz, and various other aspects. So therefore, now when it comes to reading of the kalima in the start, baby is born, you cannot expect the baby to recite La ilaha illallah, right? And as a guardian of your baby, you cannot write a document and take thumb impression of the baby. So that becomes as an origin. Any point of time, he can just fall back. It is a social norm the parents will be having that you should not do this, you should not do that, you should not do any point of time. Even if he becomes 18 and if he falls back, no, I do not understand, so I take up Christianity. There are a lot of, if you browse YouTube, you'll find a lot of people who have converted from Islam to many other religions. So basically, the Islamic law is more of a contractual binding on the contractual binding, and it enshrines principles of laws and recognizes each person's rights. When it recognizes each person's right, when you leave, it's done. Or if you accept, there are certain conditions. Like for the conversion, Asif, there would be a lot of prescriptions as to reciting Shahada and other things, and declarations which is have to be given and notified in the Gazette, saying that the person has converted to Islam on this particular date and accepted this faith. Those are the documentations. So therefore, during the time of minorship, what I would say is his decisions are not binding. Before he is he doesn't attain a age of maturity in his Sharia law, or if you see in Indian Majority Act as well, up to 18 years, you see, you cannot even sign any documents on your behalf because you are not having the capacity. That basically will be dealt in contract law, wherein, you know, the contract by a minor and stuff, So therefore, keeping all those things conditions in mind, the things which minor does will be counted as something which is not properly done in a proper mindset. Now there is a reason for that also. By the law, see, Islamic law adopts these principles very corely, which is a contractual principle that minor cannot enter into an agreement, because the law is from the reason, dictate of reasons, what, that he is not in a capacity to take proper decisions. Likewise, in Muslim law as well, after 18, it is there is an ayat or a verse in Quran. I would like to highlight to everybody here, to in order to, you know, understand Muslim law very easily. It says in one of its last surahs, it says lakum dinukum waliyadin. That means to say, Allah orders in his holy book and says, tell, oh Prophet Muhammad, tell them that you will follow your faith and let them follow their faith. So that's always a stretch given. No one is forcing, and there will not be any force in Muslim law. It is very wrong if people try to say that, you know, there are conversions which happens and stuff, or reversions that happens. It's a very free religion. Anybody who has logic and who understands and gets into this religion is doing it in its full senses. So there is no question of, you know, any rights being hampered or any rights being taken away and so forth. And anytime after 18, he is free whether to follow or not to follow. The consequences will bear as per them in the day of judgment, as they claim, the aftermath life and so forth. So that is where I say that minors, the question what you have asked about the minors, will not play that much role. And the person is always free to choose in most in this religion of Islam, because it's completely contractual. You get into it through a contract, saying, declaring that he is the one and I follow your prophet. And if you are coming out, it is taken as you are out of the religion. So it's quite logical. It's quite, this religious law is quite having its own reasons. So it will depend on, the facts and circumstances as to when the particular minor is taking up a decision for Shahada, or how this is being done, or whether there are any implications or anything of that sort. And anytime after 18, he's free to do whatever he wants. So as long as he is acquainted and learnt about his religion well, you will see a Muslim even after 18 who continues. Or if you find some problem, there are instances, various people in YouTube, you can see they have gone to other religions as well. So there's no compulsion as such in this particular aspect. It's quite free. It's a free flow.
But sir, one quick doubt. As per Quran, if a person who believes in Islam leaves Islam, that is a sin, right?
See, Sainesh, the problem in understanding Muslim law is that people always relate to a term which is in Quran, which is kafir. Kafir is the term which they refer to the unbelievers. Now, in countries like in certain countries, often people take up these things as to upon their religion, or is it telling that, you know, it's against Hindus or Buddhists or Christians, Jainism. It basically, if you understand the depth of it, it means a non-believer in the oneness of God. That is, if he doesn't believe that one God. And the second very important aspect is that he should not involve God with anything else. He did not associate God with anything else, is what they feel. So that is the reason that they say that that is the reward, no? That is the conditions. Like I told you, like a contract it is. It's like a contract. It's like a pact. Everything in Islam is like a pact. You do this, you will get this. So you do this, you will not get this. So therefore, what they say is, if you leave the path, then you will fall into things which you might do in derogation of the core principles. That is, the most core principle is, the most core principle. The only problem with this thing, Islamic law, which people do not want to acknowledge, is that the Allah does not want the one God, the who's the omnipotent God, he does not want to be, compared, or he does not want another person or another god or another thing to be made god. That is the basic conflict which they have. But ultimately, that is their belief. Who knows, the belief of their sin might be different from what other people believe. So when you do not believe, so what I always tell my students in all the lectures I've gone through various law schools, that, you know, you should always have the secular mindset as to, if you are not belonging to the system, nothing in the system will apply on you. So when nothing applies on you, there is no question of, you know, taking it as in, sir, they are saying that we will go to hell, they are going to heaven. What if their hell is your heaven, your hell is their heaven? So we don't know. Have you seen it? We have not seen anything. So whatever happens, it is a faith. So they believe in certain things. You don't believe in certain things. So it's just, their system is different, our system is different. So I believe that the moment it stays that way, we will never have any issues with, you know, tolerance and secularism and all. There'll always be people, you know, very with peace and harmony and stuff. That is their belief. We'll have our belief. That is what I read out to you in Quran, no? Lakum dinukum waliyadin. That is what they believe also. Whatever you respect, whatever you do it. We totally respect. Whatever we do, let us do it. Please respect. Respect in the sense, not like come bow down and respect. Accept that we are like this. The law is like this. Just accept. So I think that might answer your question, Mr. Sainesh.
Yeah, from the secularism part of it, yes, sir, completely.
Yeah, that is it. That is it. See, when you don't
apostasy
have...
Apostasy part of it, I'm still not kind of clear, but we can definitely take
moral,
in...
See, moralistic point of view, if you take, and if you take it in the reading of theology, that you will have various questions. So, that is a different aspect altogether. Now, we are looking into the legal aspect part of it.
Ah, okay.
Legal aspect of it, what we see is that they have a stand. There is a logic, they have made it. And our logic is this. And in law, we have equality. When we accept that we are right, we need to also accept that things which this person is not doing to harm my rights is also correct. This I will have a very particular lecture as to jurisprudence if you want.
Okay.
I will explain how the right and duty concept actually works. So there is very famous quote, okay, wherein very... a famous law scholar, the homework is for you people to find out and let me know, that who says that my right ends where his nose starts. Find out. This is a thing for you, I mean, test for you people. It is a very interesting thing. There is a phrase wherein it says, no, that my right of swinging the arm ends where your nose starts. So I can swing my arm however I want. But what is the limitation of my right?
It till I reach your nose.
Hurt your nose.
Correct.
Sorry, Sinesh?
Yeah, I was agreeing to you. Till I reach the other person's nose.
Ah, so that is how we need to understand the concept of harmony of laws. As long as the law is not you know, affecting me, that is acceptable by me. If it is affecting me, then the things will go to the court and we shall mend the laws. And we shall fight for justice.
Professor.
Okay. Sure.
Okay. Thank you, Haru. Today we have set up a stage for understanding the Mohammedan law, Islam law. We would be in future, like maybe next week or this week, whenever you have time. So everybody would love to know, like, how the marriage laws, inheritance succession laws. Okay. I think I only one word I would like to say, party abhi baki hai. So all students, we have to wait for next session of Haru. We will take, we'll start questions in the next session with the next topic. And thank you, Harun, for a wonderful seminar again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So thank you all participants. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you,
sir.
Yes, thank you.